In today's video, we are going to be talking about kenophobia. I'm not joking, I'm perfectly serious, and kenophobia is fear of the empty space. In the visual arts, it simply means filling the entire surface of the artwork with fine detail. So we can relate it to super busy landscape images, particularly images that are featuring trees. So today I'm going to show you three very simple techniques that can help you to take control over your landscape images and simply turn them into balanced visual artwork. Coming up. Okay, so for today's video, I came up with this term kenophobia, but I didn't make it up. You can check it out. And basically, this relates very strongly to me. And I have to say that I really hate such busy images. And I can say this about my work, and I can say about any artwork. So if I'm looking at something that has plenty of negative space, I have to say that I prefer this type of artwork. So when I'm talking about this, I'm thinking about Japanese painting, when you have plenty of flat surfaces, or when you have Klimt, you still have a lot of detail, you have a lot of pattern, but there is some order in these compositions. But when you are shooting on a sunny day, if you go out for a walk to the forest, and if you have, unfortunately, wide-angle lens, so this is the shortest way of basically bringing disappointing images. So my first advice, my first tip, this is not included in the techniques because it relates basically to the lens choice. So as you can see, I have taken these images with 85 millimeter lens. If we just move over quickly to the metadata, you can see that I've taken them with Nikon. This one, I had set my camera at quite shallow depth of field, for the lens allowed me to even shoot at 1.4, but I went for 4 here, the same. Basically, we have exactly the same settings. So as you can see, 85 mil, this is a portrait lens. This might sound really weird. Why on earth I would go to the forest to photograph trees with a portrait lens? And I would really encourage you to experiment, to do this. You don't need to buy a portrait lens, just use anything with a bit less wide lens, because typically the lenses that would be recommended for landscape, or if you just go into some beautiful places when you have panoramic view, the first choice would be, okay, I need to buy the wide angle lens, and in most cases it works. But if you are working with trees, if you want to photograph forest, to me, I have found out that it is way easier to work with portrait lens. So if you are working with your wide angle lens, you see a lot, you see basically 50 trees in a row, and you don't see the details. You are basically not able to focus on the fine detail. Let me just switch on the browser and let me display just one image. So if you are working with a portrait lens, you are seeing just a fraction of the scene in front of you, and you can really start seeing those beautiful compositions. You can start seeing details, you can start seeing those variations in colors, and this can be really, really helpful. Plus, if you have a lens that allows you to create a shallow depth of field, this can be really, really helpful as well. Okay, so let's jump over and let's cover the first technique that I would recommend when we are working on such a busy nature images. So let me in fact create new variant. So this is my original image, and You can see that in comparison with the edited image where I have applied my techniques, this one is super chaotic and most probably you just delete it right away. So there is so much going on. The scene is such a disappointment. Definitely it doesn't reflect what I was looking at that point, because I liked the scene, I liked the composition, and I pressed my shutter. However, what I brought home, well, I'm not that happy with the result. But after playing around with that image and after just checking certain things that can be done, I was able to produce something like this, and I must say that I really, really like this final effect. So let's see what can be done. So my first technique, my first recommendation would be to apply a matte effect to your images. So what the matte effect does, it will basically decrease contrast and it will get rid of all those tones that are inside the dark tone. So you won't have any more all those tonal variations inside the blacks and dark tones, but this will sort of create a negative space inside your image, and this will help basically to get rid of some unwanted detail. So let's jump over to the exposure tab, and the very first adjustment that I always perform would be to go to levels and just apply auto levels. So that way Capture One automatically stretch the data across the histogram. So now we have no gaps. Before we had a bit of gap of the information here, so we had no highlights and we had no blacks. So now after just applying the auto adjustment, everything looks fine and we can start working on the edit. So the first technique, we will be applying matte effect. So let's create new field adjustment layer and let's rename it. Let's call it matte effect. So adding the matte finish, it basically means lifting the black points. So when you do this, you will get rid of all the unwanted detail and you will make certain areas in your image flat depending on luminosity ranges. So let me show you how you can super quickly do this. So we will be working with curves. Let's pull our curves out of the panel. Let's make it bigger so we have more precision. We can hide the browser. So all we need to do here is to just create control point, anchor the curve, and then lift our black point. So that way we will be making the blacks brighter, but we will maintain our darkest shadow here. So this point, this anchoring point, is very, very important. We don't want to darken our highlights, we don't want to darken our midtones, so we can control another control point around here to anchor our curve. Okay, so something like this, we can go with this one even a little bit lower here and push this one upwards. So this can be fine-tuned on the Luma curve, and here we can experiment, but basically this typically benefits if we push the Luma downwards, so this will dim the image, so that way we will be adding a little bit mood to the entire image. Let's go darker here with the shadows and let's jump back to our RGB. So this is before and this is the after. You can see how flat this area gets. So after lifting my black point, you need to be careful, you need to observe it. If you would like to apply this adjustment on batch of images, you need to fine-tune this for every image because you can create some artifacts here. But in general, the whole trick is based on lifting the black point and anchoring the point here in the dark shadows, so you are not making your image washed out, but you don't have those pure blacks anymore. Okay, so something like this. So that way you can see that I have managed to make the area that contained blacks, that contained darker tones, I have managed to sort of flatten it out. You can see this is reflected here in this part of the curve. It is flat. The steeper the curve is here in our graph, the stronger the contrast. So basically by flattening the curve here, I've managed to flatten all my dark shadows and blacks. So again, the image before and the image after. So before the adjustment, you have the histogram, the data that is stretched across the whole graph. We have very strong colors, a lot of contrast here. This branch is very, very distracting. And after applying our matte effect, you can see how this actually changed our histogram. So take a look at this one. Before, the data is stretched across the graph. After, you have this gap of information here to the left-hand side, which means that there are no longer any blacks in the image and there are no dark tones. So this is my first tip that can really, really help you to simplify your images, to introduce a little bit of negative space in such a busy original images. And this is super helpful when you are photographing trees and forest. So now the second tip, it has to do with color. So again, to simplify, to make your image more balanced, we want to simplify it first in terms of luminosity. So we've done this with the matte effect. Now I want to simplify it in terms of color. So we have plenty of greens here. We have a little bit of those sort of brownish, yellowish tones here, and this creates this sort of scattered pattern. And I want to just sort of tame it and make it a little bit more monochromatic, and then I can work on my chosen color accents. So let's create one more field adjustment layer, and on this one, we'll be focusing on color. So first of all, the first thing I want to do is to desaturate the image a bit. So let's just move over to my color tab, and in my color editor, let's go for advanced. Let's click on this little plus here. So that way I will be affecting all colors in my image. I'm not going to be using the picker. Whatever I do here, this will affect the whole image. So I'm just going to go for negative value on saturation. This is too much. I don't want to desaturate the image entirely. I want to just fine-tune colors in the next step, but simply pushing my saturation towards negative value around negative 20, this gives me a better base. I'm not distracted by all these strong colors, and now I can work towards fine-tuning these colors. So I'm going to be working on color grading with my color balance tool. Let's just pull it out. So when it comes to the master, I think I will leave it as it is. The image is already very green. It has a bit of this warm light, so I think I can leave it for the end, or I can just skip this entirely. So let's start with shadow. So here the strongest color that I will be introducing will be in midtones, because the image consists mostly of midtones. We have no shadows, we have a bit of dark midtones, plenty of midtones here, and quite a lot of nice bright midtones and highlights. So the strongest effect on the image will be manipulating with midtones. This is the luminosity range that I will be affecting with color balance. So when it comes to midtone, I want to introduce a bit of warm tones. So let me go for something between the yellow and orange. So, okay, something like this. I think this introduces a lot of this nice sunny atmosphere. So this conveys the atmosphere of the day when I was taking the image, and it just makes this image look more radiant, if you will. So before, quite cold greens, even sort of cyanish tones. After desaturating and after introducing the warm tone, it already has changed, and I want to darken my midtones. So by darkening the midtones, I'm creating very strong contrast in terms of luminosity, because I've been covering luminosity on the first layer with the matte effect. Now I have introduced some color to the midtones, but these sliders are super, super powerful inside the color balance tool. The color balance tool can be used not only to work on color, but you can really super precisely further adjust luminosity ranges. So we are in the midtones, and now I have this slider that allows me to only tackle my midtones. So if I go down, I will be darkening the midtones, I will be further simplifying the image. If we go for Y, this is the original image. We have plenty of detail. Every single centimeter in this image is filled in with fine detail. If I just zoom in, this is 100%. So there is so much going on in this image that I'm not really enjoying looking at it before editing. So now, after introducing the matte effect and after working a bit on color, the image got already so much more harmonious. So I have darkened my midtones, I have introduced this warmer tone to my midtones, and now I want to quickly jump over to shadows, and here I want to go for complementary color and create a little bit of color contrast. So let's go for something like this, still on the greenish side, but not that strong. And this one, let's see. No, I don't want to go down, because this way I will be bringing back the contrast, and I don't want to lift the blacks either. I've already done this with my matte effect. So let's just stick with cooling a little bit those shadows. So this is what we've done on our shadows luminosity range. Let's now jump over to the highlights, and let's maybe add some warmth to the highlights as well. Highlights we have basically here in the central part of our composition in this beautiful grass here. So I want to go for something like this, and let's see if I make those highlights even brighter. So, okay, this works well. Let's check exposure warning. We are now clipping some highlights apparently here. Let's zoom in and let's check. If I hover over here and if I take color readouts, I'm clipping basically only reds, I would say. So if I hover over here, I have 254 for the reds. Okay, on the luminosity we are close as well, because clipping would be 255. So I will just jump over to my HDR tool, and here I will go down with highlight. So this way I have recovered some detail, and I can keep my highlights brighter, but maybe not that extremely. So, okay, something like this. So this will be before and after. So with this warm tone, with introducing the orange and yellow, we have created those nice, very rich, creamy tones. And I think they are enriching this image a lot in comparison with the original image, sort of washed out and on a way colder side, so without matte effect. So now matte effect, we have added a little bit of color, plus we have been manipulating with the luminosity ranges. So I would like to actually go back to my matte effect and fine tune my curves. So just to be on a bit brighter side when it comes to the highlight, something like this. I want to have my blacks flat, but to get a little bit more punch for the highlight. So I think something like this is sufficient. So color, this is my second tip. By first of all desaturating, you can basically tame all the colors in your image, and then you can decide which particular colors you would like to accentuate, which colors you want to have in your image, and which ones you would like to get rid of. This, if you would like to go more into detail, you can do this with the advanced color editor. So here you can pick specific tones and you can either make them stronger or you can remove them. So when we are talking about making particular color stronger, I want to show you, when we are still on the second tip, how you can introduce a color accent to your image that can still help to harmonize your composition. And by the way, if you're getting value from my videos, I will be super happy if you leave me thumbs up, if you subscribe to my channel, and if you leave me a comment under this video. I reply to every single comment to my videos. I'm super curious on your feedback and I would like to hear your future video suggestions. Your suggestions so far were super, super inspiring, super interesting, and many of the videos that I have recorded are actually based on your suggestions. So go ahead, leave me the comment down below. I'm always interested in your feedback. And if you like the video, if you're getting value, leave me a thumbs up. So going back to our editing process, we are still on the tip number two. We are talking about color. And now I want to show you how with the color editor, you can add color accent to your image. This is actually super, super simple. All you need to do is to just really take a close look at your image and analyze your image in terms of color. So here we have plenty of those sort of matte, silverish, desaturated greens. So they are now working way more harmoniously than at the beginning with all these different shades and sort of chaos combined with all those details. So what I'm looking now is to find a complementary color for those greens that I could put more emphasis on. And actually, if we look closer here, we have those leaves. So if I go again for Y, so this is my image before any color adjustment. So it means that I have this color in the image, I have this data, and I can play around with this. So after the saturating, this got more unified with the rest, but if I want, I want to bring it back. And actually, I want to do this. I want to introduce a little bit of saturated orange, so this will appear here, here in the grass and in those leaves. So this will create this nice strong interest point. So let's zoom in and let me just sample in one of these leaves. I'm on my color layer, all fine, advanced color editor. Let's get the picker and let's find some area with this quite saturated yellow. In fact, I can go for Y, so this will make things a little bit easier. Okay, so let's sample, I think, in this one. So I need to pick it and click somewhere here. Perfect. So I have my color sample, and now all I need to do is to just, first of all, click on this icon to make sure that the whole saturation range is included. And now let's go for stronger saturation. So I'm making those yellows super strong. This is already, of course, too much. We have to be light-handed here. So it's all about finding good result with balance. And I don't want to go for yellows. I want to go more on the orangey side. So I'm going to push this one actually in the opposite direction, because by pushing this slider to the right, I'm going the opposite way on the color wheel. This dot represents where I have sampled. So here is my sort of orangey, peachy tone. And if I push the slider to the right, I'm going in the opposite direction inside the color wheel and I'm introducing greens. But I want to introduce oranges, so I need to go the other way, which means I need to go towards the left. So that way I went from yellows towards more of the orangey tones, and I can increase saturation, so this doesn't bother me that much in comparison with the yellows, because I want to have this sort of strong color accent in the image. So let's zoom in, so we'll see what is happening here. And you can see, so if I just press and hold Alt key and click on the arrow, I temporarily disable the color work, and this is what I'm getting. So we can go for a bit stronger saturation, but not on this one. On this one, we have desaturated the image. So remember to pick the particular color that you want to adjust. This is very, very important to avoid creating any further chaos here. So let's go for stronger saturation. Maybe it's a bit too strong, but I'm just going for quite high values. Maybe it's a little bit too much, but I want you to see what I'm after. So if I would go for a really subtle effect, you might not be able to actually see it on the compressed MP4 file. So I think something like this works well. So again, before applying this adjustment on our color layer and introducing color accent. So this was my second tip. This was relating to color. So by harmonizing color, by desaturating them and then sort of pushing them towards one color range, this can help a lot making your images simpler, making them more visually balanced. And if you want, you can in the end apply a little bit of color accent, so that way you will accentuate certain elements in your image. This can be helpful as well, and this works particularly well if you are introducing a complementary color. Okay, so this was my second tip, and now I want to jump to the last tip, and this one will be about creating a vignette. So let me just show you what sort of vignette I have in my mind. So let's create new field adjustment layer. So you see right from the beginning that I'm not going for the typical custom vignette that I can find here in the exposure tab at the very bottom. We have vignette in, because this one, it will sort of darken the whole image along all the edges. So if I go towards negative value, you can see that I'm creating something like this, and this looks just too Instagram-ish to my like. So we are not going to use this. I'm going to show you instead how you can create a beautiful custom vignette with the radial gradient tool. It depends on an image, but for this one, the oval and the radial gradient will work perfectly well. So let's just create our oval. So all I want to do is to just darken the bottom and those upper corners of my frame, because I want to have the center of the frame as the most important element, and then I want to basically fade the rest. So let's hit M. This is the preview of my mask, and I want to invert it. So invert mask. So this will be my vignette now. Let's rename this layer and let's call it vignette. Okay, so let's maybe decrease a bit of the size of the inner circle, so that way we will have more of the vignette here. So let's maybe go for something like this. Okay. Let's hide the preview. And now on this vignette, I'm not going to apply the typical operation. So typically what people would do would be to go for negative exposure. So if I do this, I will darken the bottom and the top part of the image. And this would be the simple way. But I want you to analyze this a little bit further. So if we think what is usually the viewer's attention goal towards when we are looking at the image, we would say, of course, our eye would go towards bright objects, so bright versus dark. That's why we would go for negative exposure, just to darken those areas that we want to sort of push back. But apart from going for negative exposure, we can go as well for negative contrast. So if we will manipulate now with our contrast value. And if we, let's first go for positive value. So this is the opposite effect that we want to get. If I start increasing contrast, you can see that the part of the image that was masked gets important. It gets contrasty, it gets basically shouting. And instead of being sort of quiet and pushed towards the backward, it gets important. So we want to achieve the opposite result. So I'm going to go for negative contrast. So by introducing this, I'm making these areas softer and I can combine it with negative brightness values. So by decreasing my brightness, I'm not introducing such a heavy, strong, dark vignette as in case of working with negative exposure. Of course, we can add a bit of negative exposure to the mix, but this sort of looks fake. This looks super artificial, but if we are operating instead with contrast and brightness, the vignette is way more subtle and the overall effect is way more balanced. So we have applied on our vignette negative contrast, negative brightness, and we can add as well a bit of negative clarity. So let's see what happens if I start pushing my clarity slider towards the left hand side. As you can see, the bottom of my image got softened. So clarity basically affects the most midtones. If I would go this way, I will be again adding punch to these areas of the image, and I want to achieve just the opposite. So I want to go towards the negative value, and that way I have softened these parts of the image that basically I want to turn the viewer's attention away from. So let's again take a look at the preview of my mask so we can even extend it a bit more. And let's take a look like this. Maybe it's a little bit too harsh, so let's make it larger that way, but let's make the transition softer. So basically, if I hit M here on this line, we will have zero adjustment. On the middle one, 50%, and on this one, you will always have 100% of the intensity of the adjustment. So, okay, let's take a look again. So this is before applying the vignette and after. So this is very, very subtle. Of course, if you want, you can always add to the mix the negative exposure. So here, this one, you can make it a little bit bigger, but don't overdo this, especially if you are working on a landscape, if you are working on a portrait, and if the portrait was taken, especially indoors, you can get away with this because no one knows what was the light. But here, when the scene was quite evenly lit, I would say that introducing such a strong negative exposure and creating this strong dark vignette just looks artificial. So let's go for something maybe negative 0.2. So this already darkens the image. This already brings the viewer attention to the middle. Or maybe let's make this vignette a little bit bigger. Let's make the oval a little bit bigger, so basically it doesn't cover such a huge bottom part of the image. So again, this is the preview of the mask. Okay, I think now it works well. So these are my three tips when it comes to simplifying nature images. And when I'm looking at the image now, I would say that after introducing this color accent, the image got a little bit too warm. I have pushed it a little bit too strongly on a warm side. So basically, let's see if I keep my highlights neutral. No, they are too whitish. So this was fine, but I'm going to reduce saturation on my midtones. So I will have more of these silverish tones, and this will be beautifully balanced between the luminosity ranges, between the lights and shadow, and that very, very subtle color. So let's take a look again. This is before, this is the after. And now I want to show you that once you have all the adjustments created for one image, so again, original and edited image, you can copy all of them and try to apply to another one taken with similar lighting condition. So I want to basically create a new variant of this one. So this image is not edited and I want to take the one that we've been just working on. Let's copy all our adjustments. Let's display this one beside, and on this one, I want to apply these adjustments. So you can see that once we are happy with the adjustments on one image, and if we have more images taken at the same place with similar light, we can try to reapply them and we can try to create a series of consistent images. And what is the most important is the fact that it works the same on the second image, which was super busy as well. So here we had a little bit more dynamic composition with this diagonal line going up, those strong branches. But again, there was so much detail in the background, so much detail in the foreground that basically the eye was lost. When we are looking at this image, we have this line, but there is nothing that is holding our attention. But after applying those simple adjustments from the first edit, we have way more balanced image. And of course, we can still fine-tune it. So let's say if I would make it a little bit more saturated, I can always jump back to my color layer. We were working in a non-destructive way. And I can see if I switch it off entirely, this will be my image without the saturating. And I think it works quite well. I have now those very beautiful rich greens. So I can maybe go for not negative 21, but something like negative 2 or 3. And if I want to have that image consistent, I can do the same here. So let's see, instead of negative 21, I can go for negative 5. So we have some of these greens back. And no, I think actually this is distracting. So let's go for something like negative 15 and negative 15 here as well. I don't like those warm greens here. So if I would like to leave the image with stronger saturation, I would need to work on these greens first. So I would have to sample those greens that consist so much of yellow. I'm talking about this image here. Okay, so I would need to go here, sample somewhere here, let's say, and try to fine-tune this color. So I would maybe go for desaturating this one or pushing it towards colder side, because if I would go for the left-hand side, as you can see on the sample here and on the image I'm introducing red, I want to go for colder tone. So I just want to get rid of those yellows. So that way you can continue working on your image. You can continue fine-tuning color if you want even more polished final artwork. So now we can change the background to white and we can see that the images are looking really consistent, really fresh, but they are not that hectic, not that chaotic, and not that busy as at the very beginning. So these are my three tips for you when you want to simplify your super busy landscape images. So first of all, change your lens. So if you were working with wide angle lens, try portrait lens. First tip, matte effect. So with the matte effect, we are lifting the black point and we are basically getting rid of the detail in the shadows and in dark tones. Then work with color, desaturate color, work towards simplifying color in your image. And if there is such a need, if you have a potential in the image to do this, you can introduce a strong color accent as I've done in case of this image with this strong saturated orange color. And the last tip, the third tip, was to introduce a vignette. So the vignette works particularly strong in the second image. Let's just select this one. So this is without and this is the vignette. So you can see how this helped to hold the composition to keep the emphasis on this very dynamic diagonal line that is here in the middle of the composition. So these are my three simple tips to help you polish your landscape photography. So thank you very much for watching. For those of you who want to learn more about Capture One, I have a comprehensive course on Capture One, and until the end of this week, there is a Black Friday promotion, so you can get 20% off on every single of my courses. So this applies as well to the Capture One course. You can check the link down below, so you will see my page where I have all my courses, digital art classes, and you can apply the 20% off discount on every course that you would like to try out. So thank you very much for watching. This was Kasia Zmokła from Digital Art Classes, and I will see you very soon in the next video. Thanks for watching. See you by now.